This is Ollie Brockett here for Low Kick MMA. Joining me today is the infamous Bellator lightweight, AJ the Mercenary McKee, ahead of his upcoming bout against Ryzen lightweight champion Roberto De Souza, in the Bellator Ryzen crossover event this December 31st. AJ, thank you very much for your time. How are you doing today?
Oh, another day in paradise, man. Thank you for having me. How are you doing?
I'm not too bad. It's a little bit late here. We've got the snow going. It's a bit icy, so... just trying to keep warm.
You gotta pull the snowboard out, man. Go hit the streets.
what about yourself? Are you looking forward to Christmas?
Nah, I'm looking forward to New Year's, man, honestly. Christmas is gonna be it's gonna be spent in Japan, so it's not gonna be something too appetizing, and they don't really celebrate Christmas in Japan, so somebody told me they go to like KFC or something.
What are your plans for New Year's in Japan?
Hopefully knock out Robert. outside of that, man, just I'm pretty sure New Year's is really big. I'm big into the car scene and cars. So, you know, I know all the car people, they're not going to be out drinking and whatnot. They'll probably be at a car meet somewhere. So. Hopefully I get linked up with some people and I can go to a nice car meet or something, go see some R34s and some just a nice car meet, you know what I mean? But I'm really intrigued to see some R34s.
I know when you won the Bellator tournament, you went and spent a bit of that money on your cars, didn't you?
Yeesh. You have no idea. Quite a bit. And I added, I got a Toyota Supra, I got an S2000, I got my Honda CRX, I've been had that. What else? I got my Cadillac, CTSV 2018 Championship Edition, and I also have a 2012 Grand Sport Corvette.
Wow. Don't mean to flex.
dude, it's a problem. My dad gets pissed at me. And this is the cold part about them. Out of all the cars, only two of them drive.
So what car are you in right now?
My Honda. Good old faithful Honda. That's 2000. That's 2000 in the caddy drive. Those two drive right now. The rest of them are just kind of under operation, shall we say.
You're doing some modifications, I'm guessing.
Yeah, the Supra, we're going to go 2J, 2JZ, big turbo. I just purchased all the stuff, sent the head and the block out. So we're going to build that to about 1,300 horse, down-tune it to 11, and have it reliable. My CRX, I'm going all-wheel drive in. 700 horse. What else? The Corvette, that thing's built, blower, headers, cammed, everything, about 800. S2000, I might turbo it, maybe. I just got to find the time. Well, I'm going to turbo it. I've purchased everything already. I just haven't had time to do it. So.
Well, you're going to have some time after New Year's Eve, hopefully. Let's get into this. Earlier this year, you made your pro lightweight debut against Spike Carlisle in your hometown, Long Beach, California. What was it like to do what you love to do in front of your fans? And did it feel like a long time coming, considering you've been such a big commodity in Bellator?
No, it was fun, man. It was fun. I wish we could have done the Grand Prix finals in Long Beach. That would have been phenomenal. But at the same time, I don't want people complaining anymore about, oh, it's his home turf. But doing it at the Forum in Inglewood, you know, just all the greatness that's been in those red walls and within those walls, it was very fun. And then obviously coming to the city, man, and having him headline over me, it was a bit rough spot. But I had to go show him why I am the main event, even though I was the main event, if you know what I mean. And it was just a great time, man. It was a great time to have all my friends, all my family there. The whole city was there, and just to have everybody there rooting for me.
Oh, hell yeah. It was absolutely fireworks. I loved the fight. And I saw you shortly after, actually. You went on a show with Ariel Helwani, and you showed off your massive freezer full of humongous steaks. And I can't lie, I was so jealous when I saw that. And I had to ask, for you, after a long day of training, what is AJ McKee's go-to steak meal? Like, what are you having, a side of chips, side of lobster? What are you going for?
Surf and turf, baby, all the way. You know, you got to have that ribeye with some lobster tail. Yeah, that's the go-to, surf and turf all day.
Oh yeah, I had some steak last night. Well, tonight actually, I had some sweet potato mash. If you've ever had that with it.
Yeah, well, sweet potato mash. No, I've had mashed potatoes, but not mashed sweet potatoes.
Yeah, I'll have to
I'm
put you on that. It's very nice. You put
gonna
some
try
gravy
it.
on top.
A little bit of gravy, a little bit of cinnamon in there, make it sweet and spicy at the same time. That would be pretty good. I think I'm gonna try that tonight.
Yeah, for sure. It gets your carbs
Yeah.
in as well.
I usually do the
So,
yams. I like the yams. The yams are where it's at, you know.
now ahead of your upcoming fight, throughout your career, you've had two international fights, one in Ireland, one in Italy. This will be your third fight abroad, sorry. How do you feel going in out to Japan? Are you excited?
Definitely, man. I'm mostly intrigued and excited for the rules, you know, the soccer kicks in the knees to the grounded opponents. Since I was a kid, I've dreamed of it, you know, just watching the Pride days and so forth, watching Rampage powerbomb people on their heads, Sakuraba, and everybody just kneeing and stomping people on their face. So, I mean, you know just as well as I do, every street fight ends with a good soccer kick to the face. So I'm looking forward to just being a bit barbaric out there and utilizing some skills the mercenary doesn't normally get to use.
I can't wait. And competing in a promotional crossover event will also be a first, like you said. Are you a fan of the crossover between Bellator and Ryzen? Is there any added pressure coming into these fights?
I wouldn't say there's an added pressure. For me, I love the crossovers, you know. I like to go somewhere else, explore new land, you know. It's like any king back in the day. It's divide and conquer. You got to go conquer that new land. So, for me, it's a great opportunity to just once again show that I'm the best fighter in the world, no matter the division, no matter the organization where I am. It's just going out there and proving my point, you know, proving to the world who AJ the Mercenary McKee is.
I love that, man. While being there, as you said, Pitbull is going to be in Japan as well. Do you expect any added tension between you and him?
Not really. I mean, last time we were cordial. He plays this whole cordial thing, you know. He wants to be friends and shake hands, but at the end of the day, man, we're both warriors, we're both fighters. And I think it's inevitable. I would hope it's inevitable for us to cross paths again, but I know if it was up to him, it wouldn't happen, and it's not gonna happen. That's why he's talking about going to 135-pound division and so forth. So I don't know. Hopefully Mr. Coker makes it happen, man. He's the man with the plan, so I think it'll happen.
I'd love to see the trilogy bout. I think it would be crazy. But how do you feel your training camp has gone for this fight in Japan? Is it any different preparing for an international bout?
Not really. I would say just trying to get acclimated fighting in a ring. That's a bit different, you know. Especially for a takedown artist like myself. I like to prop people up against the cage and then, you know, sit there and be lazy for a second and then take them down whenever I want. Versus this is going to be a fight where immediately, as soon as I touch the legs, I'm going to have to cut the corners and get them to the ground, you know. So it's being cognitive of those little things, being aware of taking sloppy shots. You can't take sloppy shots, you know. You want to stay off your knees so you don't get kneed in the head, and yeah, just little things like that, you know. I hired a very high level jiu-jitsu guy, Jeremiah Vance. He's been working with me a lot, and yeah, that's about it, man. We've been putting in that work.
So, talking about your training, is there any aspect of your MMA game that you feel like you've had to constantly focus on? So, like, what part of do you feel like you've had to work on the most during your career?
I would say striking. Striking. There's always loopholes in striking, and you can always evolve your striking. There's always new techniques, just new angles. You know what I mean? Angles are key. Footwork is key. So it's being able to adjust and find those proper angles in the fight.
Perfect. I couldn't put that better myself, pal. So when it comes to your opponent, Roberto de Souza, what are you expecting him to show you in the cage on December 31st?
As Uncle Rampage was saying, I think he's gonna be trying to hump my leg. I think he's gonna try to wrestle a little bit. I think we're gonna come out on the feet, throw some strikes. I believe once I land a couple strikes, he's gonna see that, okay, this isn't where he wants to be, and I have a feeling that's when he's gonna try to wrestle a bit and get me to the ground, and hopefully I could pull off a flashy MVP flying knee to the face or something, you know?
So I know you're a man who always loves and aims for a finish whenever you're in the cage. So if things were to go your way against him, how are you looking to get your hand raised?
Soccer kick to the face, man. That's the whole purpose of this fight, is going out there and being able to legally soccer kick somebody in the face and get away with it, you know? It's a bit more barbaric, you know, and I think it's what the fans want. I think it's what the fans like. It's a bit more entertaining. It's not a long career doing fights like that, but it's a fun opportunity, you know, and you got to capitalize on the experience when you're able to. So this is a once in a lifetime thing.
So, when you're in the cage, you normally do a flip celebration off the cage, and like you said, you're now going to be in a ring. Have you got anything planned in the locker if you get a win with that soccer kick, especially?
I can do a flip still. We'll figure it out. We'll have
You're going to do
to
some
get in.
WWE thing across the ring.
Yeah, maybe like the people's elbow or something, you know?
Yeah.
We'll figure it out.
So, with a win on New Year's Eve, do you set your sights for a title shot against the newly crowned champion, Usman Nurmagomedov, sorry?
Definitely, you know, for me, it's all about the titles. It's about the titles and the M's. So, excuse me, with Bellator in the midst of talking about doing a 155-pound tournament, that's right up my alley, man. You're talking about another million? Sign me up, you know. I don't care. I'll work my way through the whole thing like I did last time. I'm like a dark knight riding the horse through the land, you know what I mean? I'm coming to take out everything, you know. If you're in my path, I'm taking you out. And what more motivation do I need than $1 million?
More money, more cars.
Exactly. I'm gonna need more than a mil though, man. I'm starting to look at Paganis and all kind of other crazy stuff, Bugattis. I've always been fascinated with Bugattis. So I think if I had what I like to call fuck you money, I'd probably buy a Bugatti.
If you keep on going the way you're going, you're definitely gonna get that. So, if is securing that lightweight title the main goal for you at the end of 2023 next year?
Definitely. I wouldn't say that's the main goal. It's cashing in some M's. That's the main goal. You know, getting to those M's. Obviously, the world title is, it's phenomenal. It's an achievement. It's an accolade, and it shows the work, you know, that you've put in, and it's admirable. You know, it's something you can always look at, and you can kind of go back on and just jot down those names that are on the tournament world title, you know, and look at it and say, damn. I walked through each one of these guys, or you know what I mean? I was the best of the best out of these guys, you know? And that's why I always tell Pitbull, you know, for the trilogy's sake, bro, I'll put that belt back up on the line, man. But you got to be man enough to step up to the plate, man, you know? But he's playing duck, duck, goose, man. I don't know what's wrong with this guy.
As I said, I would love to see that trilogy belt. I think it'd be the biggest pay-per-view in Bellator history, personally. But before we say our goodbyes, because I want you to, get to your training or even get inside your own house and even try the
Locking up.
steak and sweet and potato mash, sorry, that I told you about with some little bit of gravy, I wanted to give you the floor to shout out any sponsors or anyone that you want to.
Of course, my sponsors, man. I got to give all glory to the man upstairs. Without him, I wouldn't be in the position I'm in. Shout out to my father, man, my coach, my mentor, my big brother, my dad, everything all in one. My sponsors, Monster Energy, Seek Headphones, Newport Watch Club. They keep me in a bus down or iced out. Import Auto Pros Car Club. Y'all know what it is. If it ain't imported, we don't want to hear about it. I'm having a fond love with my American cars as well. Now I got the Caddy, so I think I'm turning into a Chevy boy. Who else, man? Everybody else. Peace and blessings. Shout out to you. Happy holidays to everybody, and thank you for your time, and hope everybody enjoys the show New Year's.
It's my pleasure. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to sit down and chat with us today. It's been an absolute pleasure, and I wish you all the luck on New Year's Eve. Have a great party after, and have a safe travel, my friend. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. Likewise, peace and blessings.
See you in a bit, pal.
Make sure to subscribe to the Low Kick MMA YouTube channel for all the latest news, event previews, and interviews with some of the biggest stars in MMA.